Peace Plans of Saint-Pierre and Rousseau. Saint-Pierre's Peace Plan. Abbé Charles Irénée Castel de Saint-Pierre was educated at a Jesuit college where he studied the classics, logic, ethics, physics, mathematics, and metaphysics. He joined a strict order of monks, but he had to leave it for reasons of health. He moved to Paris in 1680 and was at court from 1693 to 1718. When he was expelled from the French Academy for refusing to approve of the title Great for Louis XIV, he studied both the theory and practice of politics and was particularly influenced by Plato, Baudin, Machiavelli, Grotius, Pufendorf, Richelieu, Doria, and Hobbes. Pace Perpetual was first published in 1712, but he expanded that sketch to a two-volume edition the next year, which was translated into English in 1714 as A Project for Settling an Everlasting Peace in Europe. He added a third volume in 1717 and published Abridgments in 1729 and 1738. Saint-Pierre tried to gain publicity for his effort by giving credit to France's King Henri IV for the grand design that was actually written by the Duke of Sully years later in 1638. He attended the peace conference at Utrecht in 1713 as the secretary for the Abbé Polignac, one of the three French plenipotentiaries. This gave him first-hand experience of the peacemaking process and stimulated him to work on his plan that could make peace perpetual. Saint-Pierre attempted to use the philosophical methodology of Descartes in order to gain certainty by means of intuition and deduction. His first idea had been to include all the nations of the world, but then he limited his confederation to Europe so that the whole project would not seem impossible. Examining the various means which could prevent war among European nations, he inferred that a federation of states is the best solution. Whereas Hobbes showed that for the protection and benefit of individuals, there must be unity in the state, Saint-Pierre went a step further in reasoning that to safeguard the peace between nations, there must be a unifying federation. Although accused by Rousseau of unrealistically expecting people to be rational, Saint-Pierre did recognize that passions control the actions of most people. Therefore, to overcome motives of self-interest, the fear of violence must be used to enforce law and justice. Foreshadowing Rousseau's ideas, he posited that society protects people from violence by a contract and can express its sovereign will by establishing a permanent federation among the states of Europe. Saint-Pierre's plan took the form of an elaborate treaty divided into articles that were fundamental, important, and useful. States of various forms of government could be in the federation, though most at this time were monarchies. The laws founded on justice were to be equal and reciprocal for all. Saint-Pierre pointed to the confederations of German and Helvetian states and the United Provinces of the Netherlands to show the practical advantages of union. He began his plan with peace and contrasted this to the French war aims that would have initiated the biased plan of Sully. Saint-Pierre proposed 12 fundamental articles. First, all the Christian sovereigns of Europe shall form a permanent union for peace and security, endeavoring also to make treaties with Muslim sovereigns. And the sovereigns are to be represented by deputies in a perpetual senate in a free city. Second, the European society shall not interfere with the governments except to preserve them from seditious rebellions, and he even went so far as to guarantee hereditary sovereignties. Third, the Union shall send commissioners to investigate conspiracies and revolts and may send troops to punish the guilty according to the laws. Fourth, territories shall remain as they are unless three-fourths of the Union votes for a change, and no treaties may be made without the advice and consent of the Union. Fifth, no sovereign shall possess more than one state. Sixth, Spain and France shall remain in the House of Bourbon. These previous five articles have been criticized for not allowing a natural process of change. Seventh, chambers of commerce shall be maintained, and each sovereign must suppress robbers and pirates or pay reparations. If necessary, the Union may assist them in this. Eighth, no sovereign shall take up arms except against a declared enemy of the European society. Complaints shall be discussed and mediated by the Senate in the City of Peace. The Union shall defend the sovereigns who agree with its decisions. After at least 14 nations have joined the Confederation, any sovereign refusing to join is to be declared an enemy by the rest of Europe, which is to make war on it until the state joins or is dispossessed. The ninth article specified that the Senate was to represent with one delegate each the following 24 powers: France, Spain, England, Holland, Savoy, Portugal, Bavaria, Venice, Genoa, Florence, Switzerland, Lorraine, Sweden, Denmark, Poland, the Papal States, Muscovy, Austria, Courland, Prussia, Saxony, Palatine, Hanover, and ecclesiastical electors. Obviously, this scheme allowed extra votes for the divided German and Italian states. Tenth, each state shall contribute to the expenses of the society in proportion to its revenues. 11th, the Senate shall take up questions after a plurality vote, and 3/4 is needed for a decision. 12th, none of the fundamental articles may be altered except by a unanimous vote by all members. In the important articles, Saint-Pierre gave more details he recommended, such as Utrecht as the seat of the Senate, which shall have an ambassador in every province of 2 million people. No sovereign shall keep more than 6,000 soldiers in his nation. Enemies of the Union shall be punished with death or life imprisonment, and anyone reporting a conspiracy shall be given a reward. Every year, on the same day, sovereigns shall renew their oath to the Union. If a state has no succeeding sovereign, the Union may regulate the succession or allow a republic to be formed. The useful articles are even more specific. The commander-in-chief of the federal forces shall not belong to any sovereign family. Rotating senators shall preside week by week. The four standing committees on politics, diplomacy, finances, and war are to be supplemented by committees of reconciliation, which shall adjust difficulties or report them to the senators for their decision. Freedom of religion is allowed. The Union may agree on weights, measures, and coins. The Senate may mediate between conflicts of non-members and support the sovereign who accepts its offer. The European Union shall encourage Asia to establish a permanent society also. Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Conscience is the voice of the soul. Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Firmly convinced as I am that nothing on this earth is worth purchase at the price of human blood, and that there is no more liberty anywhere than in the heart of the just man, I feel, however, that it is natural for people of courage, who were born free, to prefer an honorable death to dull servitude. Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Jean-Jacques Rousseau was a fascinating individual whose unorthodox ideas and passionate prose caused a flurry of interest in 18th century France. His republican sentiments for liberty, equality, and brotherhood led eventually to the French Revolution. He was born on June 28, 1712, but his mother died in giving birth to him. His father had him reading romances and classical histories, such as Plutarch, before apprenticing him to an engraver. Rousseau loved to walk in nature. Frustrated at being locked outside the city gates of Geneva at nightfall, at the age of 16, he left his home to wander on his own. He was guided by a Catholic priest to Madame de Warens, who took him in for about 10 years and eventually became his mistress. Rousseau studied music and devised a new system of musical notation, which was rejected by the Academy of Sciences. Throughout his life, Rousseau often earned his living by copying music. In Paris in the 1740s, he entered literary society and wrote both the words and music for an opera, Les Muses Galantes. Rousseau lived for 30 years with an uneducated servant girl who bore him 5 children, according to his confessions, but all of them were given to an orphanage in infancy. In 1749, Rousseau burst into prominence by winning an essay contest on the theme, "Has the progress of the arts and sciences contributed more to the corruption or purification of morals?" Rousseau criticized social institutions for having corrupted the essential goodness of nature and the human heart. In his Discourse on the Origin of Inequality, he elaborated on the process of how social institutions must have developed into the extreme inequities of aristocratic France, where the nobility and the clergy lived in luxury, while the poor peasants had to pay most of the taxes. In his Discourse on Political Economy, he suggested remedies for these injustices. In 1756, he retreated to a simple country life and wrote a romantic novel, La Nouvelle Héloïse, which won the hearts of many. Some historians consider Rousseau the initiator of the Romantic Rebellion in art and literature. Rousseau's 2 greatest works were published in 1762, The Social Contract and Émile or On Education. For Rousseau, society itself is an implicit agreement to live together for the good of everyone with individual equality and freedom. However, people have enslaved themselves by giving over their power to governments, which are not truly sovereign when they do not promote the general will. Rousseau believed that only the will of all the people together granted sovereignty. Various forms of government are instituted to legislate and enforce the laws. He wrote that the first duty of the legislator is to make the laws conform to the general will, and the first rule of public economy is to administer justice in conformity with the laws. His natural political philosophy echoes the way of Lao Tzu. He suggested that the greatest talent of a ruler is to disguise his power to render it less odious by conducting the state so peaceably that it seems to need no conductors. Rousseau valued his citizenship in Geneva, where he was born, and he was one of the first strong voices for democratic principles. He believed there could be no liberty without virtue and no virtue without citizens. Rousseau explained that citizens depend upon education. In Émile, a revolutionary book in educational theory, Rousseau described how a boy can learn most naturally by direct experience. Rousseau recommended awakening the inner goodness that comes from the heart and warned against the evil contrivances of civilized society. Where are their laws and where are they respected? Everywhere you have seen only individual interest and men's passions reigning under this name. But the eternal laws of nature and order do exist. For the wise man, they take the place of positive law. They are written in the depth of his heart, by conscience and reason. It is to these that he ought to enslave himself in order to be free. The only slave is the man who does evil, for he always does it in spite of himself. Freedom is found in no form of government. It is in the heart of the free men. He takes it with him everywhere. The vile man takes his servitude everywhere. Yet Rousseau was not against positive law. On the contrary, laws protect those who are free from the vile man who violates them. We are free within the law, but again, the laws must be in harmony with reason and the general good. Rousseau's political writings stirred up controversy, and threatened by the established powers, he fled into exile to Prussia and also visited David Hume in England. Later, he was able to return to France. In 1768, a populist revolt protested for more rights against an oligarchy of 25 counselors in Geneva. Rousseau counseled against violence, but encouraged them in their struggle and predicted that in 10 or 20 years, the times would be far more favorable to the cause of a representative party. In fact, the American Revolution was about 10 years away and the French Revolution about 20. Rousseau discussed many different forms of government and indicated that there are various factors to consider in deciding on the best form of government for any given state. Generally, he favored elective aristocracy, not hereditary, but republican. In his constitutional project for Corsica, he advised them to adopt democratic government and to abolish hereditary nobility. Consulted on Poland's government, he recommended the gradual enfranchisement of the serfs and a multi-level civil service system whereby one could advance by merit. In pain, often from a prostate disorder, Rousseau's moodiness and paranoia of other influential people increased in his later years. Fearing distortions of his life by others, which actually were written later, Rousseau tried to tell all honestly in his confessions and other autobiographical works. He died on July 2, 1778. Rousseau's writing about a federation to establish lasting peace was actually a summary and critique of the plan devised by the Abbé de Saint-Pierre. In 1754, an admirer of the late Abbé, Madame Dupin, suggested to Rousseau that he bring to life the good ideas in Saint-Pierre's writings. In his confessions, Rousseau gave his reasons for taking up the project. "Not being confined to the function of a translator, I was at liberty sometimes to think for myself, and I had it in my power to give such a form to my work, that many important truths would pass in it under the name of the Abbé de Saint-Pierre, much more safely than under mine." He also explained why he felt Saint-Pierre's ideas were not effective. In the offices of all the ministers of state, the Abbé de Saint-Pierre had ever been considered as a kind of preacher rather than a real politician, and he was suffered to say whatever he pleased, because it appeared that nobody listened to him. It is noteworthy that out of the 23 volumes of Saint-Pierre's works, Rousseau selected Perpetual Peace for his first essay, which was published at Geneva in 1761. Rousseau began his description of Saint-Pierre's project by expressing the feelings in his heart. "Never did the mind of man conceive a scheme nobler, more beautiful, or more useful than that of a lasting peace between all the peoples of Europe. Never did a writer better deserve a respectful hearing than he who suggests means for putting the scheme in practice. What man, if he has a spark of goodness, but must feel his heart glow within him at so fair a prospect? Who would not prefer the illusions of a generous spirit which overleaps all obstacles to that dry, repulsive reason whose indifference to the welfare of mankind is ever the chief obstacle of all schemes for its attainment? I see in my mind's eye all men joined in the bonds of love. I call before my thoughts a gentle and peaceful brotherhood, all living in unbroken harmony, all guided by the same principles, all finding their happiness in the happiness of all." Yet Rousseau was aware of the need for hard reasoning, and he promised to prove his assertions and asked the reader not to deny what one cannot refute. Although governments have been instituted to control private wars, Rousseau lamented the national wars, which are 1,000 times worse. In The Origin of Inequality, he had described how individuals joined together to avoid conflicts, but the larger bodies reverted to even more disastrous conflicts. Hence arose the national wars, battles, murders, and reprisals, which make nature tremble and shock reason, and all those horrible prejudices which rank the honor of shedding human blood among the virtues. The most decent men learned to consider it one of their duties to murder their fellow men. At length men were seen to massacre each other by the thousands without knowing why. More murders were committed on a single day of fighting, and more horrors in the capture of a single city than were committed in the state of nature during whole centuries over the entire face of the earth. To remedy these dangers, Rousseau argued that a federal form of government must be devised to unite nations, as nations unite individuals, under the authority of law. In his time, this type of government was fairly new, but he noted that it did exist in the Germanic body, the Helvetic League, and the States General of the Netherlands. And the ancients had the Greek Amphictyons, the Etruscan Lucumnes, Latin Ferii, and the City Leagues of the Gauls. Rousseau pointed out that Europe has much in common: the history of the Roman Empire, the Christian religion, geography, blood ties, commerce, arts, colonies, and printing. Yet the violence in practice contradicts the moral ideals and rhetoric of governments. Treaties are temporary and very unstable. There are few or no common agreements on public law. And in conflicts between nations, might makes right as weakness is taken for wrong. Nevertheless, the boundaries of countries remain fairly stable because of the natural conditions of geography and culture. No one country is powerful enough ever to conquer all the others. But if nations ally together for conquest, they end up fighting among themselves. The Germanic states and the Treaty of Westphalia stabilized the international situation. The conflicts which do continually agitate never seem to result in any advantage to the sovereigns. Commerce and economics tend to keep the power of states fairly balanced. Since it is so difficult for one nation to conquer others, it is easy to see that the federation would be able to force any ambitious ruler to abide by the terms of the League. Rousseau delineated the following four necessary conditions for the success of the federation. Every important power must be a member. The laws they legislate must be binding. A coercive force must be capable of compelling every state to obey the common resolves. And no member may be allowed to withdraw. His plan proposed five articles. The first establishes a permanent alliance with a Congress so that all conflicts may be settled and terminated by arbitration or judicial pronouncement. The second article determines which nations shall have a vote, how the presidencies shall pass from one to another, and how the contribution quotas shall be raised to provide for common expenses. The third declares that existing boundaries shall be permanent. The fourth specifies how violators shall be banned and forced to comply by means of the arms of all the Confederates. The fifth article recommends a majority vote at the start, but three quarters after 5 years, and unanimity to change the articles. Rousseau explained how the six motives which lead to war are all removed by this plan. These motives are either to make conquests, or to protect themselves from aggression, or to weaken a too powerful neighbor, or to maintain their rights against attack, or to settle a difference which has defied friendly negotiation, or lastly, to fulfill some treaty obligation. Actually, the Federation makes every purpose easier to accomplish except the first, that of conquest, which it most effectively deters by gathering all powers against the aggressor. Also, under the alliance, a country need not fear a powerful neighbor, because the alliance together has far greater power. Sovereigns should not complain of losing their prerogatives, because the Federation merely is forcing them to be just. Rousseau estimated that nations would save approximately half of their military budgets. He enumerated the many evils and dangers of the prevailing conditions in Europe, such as injustice because of might, insecurity of nations, military expenses, attacks, no guarantee for international agreements, no safe or inexpensive means of obtaining justice when wronged, risk and inconvenience of wars, loss of trading during crises, and general impoverishment and lack of security. The benefits of arbitration are certainty of settling disputes peacefully, abolition of causes of disputes, personal security for rulers, fulfillment of agreements between rulers, freedom of trade, smaller military expenses, increase in population, agriculture, and public wealth and happiness. Rousseau wrote a brief critique of Saint-Pierre's project, but it was not published until 1782, 4 years after he died. First, he wondered why Saint-Pierre's plan had not been adopted, and he suggested that it was because the princes were short-sighted in their ambition and greed for power. They were too proud to submit themselves to arbitration. Their wisdom was not equal to their confidence in good fortune and the risks of war. They were too blinded by their self-interest to see the wisdom of the general good. Rousseau recounted how Henri IV had tried to use self-interest with the powers of Europe to mold together a commonwealth, but he died. Rousseau finally concluded that the only way a federation could be established would be by means of a revolution, but sensing the violence in that, he considered it as much to be feared as to be desired.